good news, good news, good news. Always good news here, right? That's why it's way better to watch these videos than anything that Hollywood is putting out, right? Which has no content at all, actually, does it? Here, only content, almost only content, which is great. I'm having the kind of experiences that one would expect during these times, okay? Very profound experiences. Several nights ago, in a dream, in a half sleep, I was greeted by this being several times, and the impression that I was given was that it was Saint Francis, and I didn't know who it was, but that was the impression I was given. And this being was just incredibly spiritual quality, and I was greeted in fraternal brotherhood. You know, no condescension or anything like that. No, it's just like a brother, greeting me like a brother, saying, "Wow, it's just terrific to see you." You know, just love you, man. It's just great. And it's like, wow, this is someone. You know, this is really someone. I didn't know who it was exactly. I was told it was Saint Francis, but I said, "Wow, is that really? I don't know Saint Francis. I mean, I understand who Saint Francis is. One of the greatest saints of Christianity, for sure." Well, I only say this now because last night I visited with Jesus, and there was a difference. So I understood that the other one was not Jesus, actually. It was Saint Francis. The visit with Jesus was very interesting. I just walked up to him. I said, "Oh, there's so-and-so." It was symbolized in a dream. I said, "I'm going to go over and say hello." And I went down and sat down, and we visited and talked and had a very relaxing time. And it was, to me, it was just completely natural. Like, whereas other people, they might think, "Oh my gosh, oh my gosh, oh my gosh. You know who that is? You know who that is?" And but it's just like two people who have deep familiarity with a subject, just visiting and talking on that subject. It was no big deal to me. But what was a big deal was the end of the visiting. Just a nice visit and a chat. He said, "Hey, do you want to come to my house?" I said, "Well, wow, your house? Well, yeah. Where is it?" He said, "Just right around the corner. Just a second house there on the corner, past the corner." I said, "Wow, that's really close." And then thinking about it, I realized that this property of his property would actually be abutting to where we actually were, which was in this alley behind us, this business, actually. And I realized that just a fence between us and his property. You could just have a gate right there. I didn't check to see if there's a gate. There could be a door or a gate. We could walk directly into his property, actually. And I looked at I visualized his house, and it was this very small, the front was very small, and it was just white, this beautiful white front of a house, like solid light or something like that, you know, just like, huh. So his property is actually abutting against this world. That's what I realized. And actually, there's just this thin fence we put up. We put up this fence so we don't see his property. But his property, we could literally just open a door and go right straight into his property. That's what I realized. I says, "Wow." Now, what was the quality? I had totally unassuming, totally humble, simple, relaxed, calm, you know, modest. He's not saying, "Look at me, look," you know, nothing like that. It's just totally peaceful, simple, calm, relaxed, treating you just like a best friend. Not saying I'm some great higher than you. No sense of I'm higher than you, you're lower than me. Just sitting on the ground, actually. Just sitting on the ground. I just came and sat on the ground, and we just, you know, chatted about ordinary chat that you, I can't kind of remember some of it, but it's very, very, you know, very warm, very friendly, but also completely calm, completely relaxed, peaceful. And again, total humility. Total humility as far as... this is just a, you know, simple. And didn't have the slightest bit of nerves. Not the slightest bit. Now, trying to tell people about that, that's the part in this world. Because we know that the Luciferians and view this as mental disease, mental illness, severe sociopathic belief system, all this kind of stuff, which is the projection of their own belief system, actually. The Luciferians are taking over this planet. They've been attempting to, and they certainly are succeeding in large measure at that. Ideologically, it's a severe war going on, ideological war. And their viewpoint is there is no Jesus. Never has been. Therefore, how can you possibly visit with Jesus? It's impossible. And what spiritual people know is that the great saints, sages, saviors, and all the ones that have come throughout history in different traditions, they're all living today. They still live. You know, they've realized their eternal being. They've realized their eternal being, that they are eternal being. Okay. And so they live with us, and they're supporting us, and they're helping us, and we can meet with them. Absolutely, we can meet with them. I've met with many such beings. Always, they're so supportive, so reassuring, so peaceful and humble and calm, you know, and loving. Always. The Luciferians, okay, insist that this is not possible, and we need to be treated, you know, like that. So, you know, you don't want to be a pariah, and nobody wants to be a pariah in their own home, in their own country, in their own in the world, right? Nobody wants to be that. The Luciferian agenda is based on the belief that interpretation is prior to what is being interpreted and superior to it. That what is being interpreted is actually being defined by interpretation. You see, so interpreting being means that the interpretation is primary, prior to being, and being takes its meaning from the interpretation. This is the attempt to reverse the direction of creation and be greater than God, obviously. Obviously, you cannot have an interpretation prior to what's being interpreted, but the Luciferians insist, oh no, this is it. It's just whimsicality, actually. But they take it very seriously. So, they believe in processing. Interpretation is processing, intellectual, mental, thought-based processing. Interpreting, okay, how do I interpret this? Instead of experiencing, they believe in processing, interpreting. So of course they worship the beast, the computer, the processor, the CPU, the super CPUs, you know. Processing power, processing speed, crunching data. They believe this is their religion. This is, they worship the beast. The beast is the CPU. And they believe that this is greater than God. And in fact, God only exists as a result of their processing power. it's the outcome of what they're doing. And in fact, they don't even recognize God at all, so to speak. They feel they've been able to you know, God. They don't even need God. That their processing is God. Their ability to process is God. So they don't want anything to interfere with their obsession with processing. So they say there's no Jesus, there's no this. Processing is prior to that, and therefore whatever they want to process is what there is. And if they don't want to process Jesus, then Jesus doesn't exist. If the computer says no Jesus, they say, well, there's no Jesus then. Yeah. How smart is that? But that's what they believe, and that's what they want everyone else to believe. And what they're going to do, of course, as I've said, there's going to be crises in the world. They're going to orchestrate a crisis which will require the governments of the world to insist upon their expertise to fix the crisis. The crisis will be unfixable without the technological capabilities, you know, the processing ability to try to sort everything out. They'll say, okay, great, we'll do that. And then they'll come in and save the day, but they'll be in charge of all this. And then they'll say to all the governments, they'll say, guess what? We're happy to do this for you, and you need us to keep doing this for you, actually, right? And also keep in mind, if we don't do this for you, the whole thing will collapse. We can collapse the whole world, you know, almost instantly, actually. And they say, but we're happy to let you continue on as governance, okay? But we just have one request of you, actually demand, is these religious people cause us to feel very uncomfortable here, like we don't belong here. And so we're really not going to stay here unless you get rid of these religious people for us. And that's the demand they're going to put upon the governments of the world. They say, if you don't get rid of these religious people, which make us feel very uncomfortable, you know, they're talking about God, they're talking about Jesus, they're talking about, you know, Buddha, they're talking about all a bunch of other, you know, religious focuses and aspiration. They say, if you don't get rid of these people who are causing us to feel so uncomfortable, we want to leave, then we're going to leave, and we're going to collapse the whole system, actually. The whole system's going to completely collapse, and no one will be able to survive. The whole planet will be plunged. Because the fact is, the whole planet runs on CPUs now, actually. So the governments of the world will say, wow, okay, and you know, no choice. That is the plan, a Luciferian plan, is wire the whole planet so everything is dependent on CPUs and processing, and make it super complex, create a crisis, world crisis, where the need to use all that computing power is absolutely necessary to keep everything from collapsing, and then blackmail the governments of the world into persecuting religious people. So they wipe them out from the planet. That's their plan, folks. That's been their plan from the beginning. This is their modus operandi. This is their MO. And of course, Jesus knows all about their MO, as do many spiritual beings, because they've used this MO over and over and over again. This is what they do. Hey, folks, it's the Adam and Eve, the serpent in the garden. Hey, I got this wonderful, you know, technology. This will make things much easier, and you can enjoy this. And then gradually make the whole world dependent upon it. I mean, banking, stock market, there's almost nothing you can say about this world that isn't highly dependent. Farming, agriculture now, trade, all distribution, everything. The whole apparatus of survival on this planet is now completely dependent on computers, computing power. Well, it's dependent to such an extent that if the sophisticated systems that have been set up are crashed, and they can be, then everything grinds to a standstill, actually. And you have ISIS taking over, right? The barbarians. So they say, hey, governments. So they know this. They know how to wire a world. They know how to get the world dependent on the technology, and then they know how to blackmail the world and say, hey, we're uncomfortable, these kooks are making us feel so uncomfortable we can't function anymore, we're going to leave. And they blackmail the governments that way. Then the governments turn against the people, the religious people of the world, and that's when the genocide, the pogroms, cultural genocide begins. This is very well known. This is their MO. So we know what their MO is, actually. Jesus knows their MO. So, met Jesus in a dream last night. Jesus says, hey, you want to come over to my house? Visit my house? It's just right around the corner here. I said, oh yeah, that'd be great. I'd love to visit your house. He said, okay. You know, like, wow. Now, the dream I sort of woke up there. I wasn't sure, how am I going to get there? Am I going to take a car, drive my car, go in his car, whatever? Then I realized that there's only this fence between where we were sitting and Jesus' property. You could just walk directly into his property we just go through a door, if we just go through a door, you don't need to drive a car around like that. Now, I think it has something to do with saying you don't need to go through space to get to this property. You go directly. So that's what I'm saying. Hey, you know, the Luciferians think, oh, how are you going to get there? You know, well, actually, it's right here. It's very simple. Once you understand the non-dual absolute, space and time is just a construct, just a construct, actually, an interpretation. It's an interpretation. Keep in mind, what we're seeing as space and time, this is just interpretation. It's not true. Just interpretation. So now that we know what the MO is of this planet, and we've been suspicious of it all along, right? Very suspicious of it all along. Look at the healthcare system. It's totally dependent now, right, on all this IT, you know, structure. I've talked to doctors. We're getting information directly from doctors. They've opened up and said, you know, this is hell. This is just horrible, what's going on. Doctors, they said, used to be able to come in and explain how it used to be. And they said, used to be so much better. The patient got information from one doctor. He said, if the patients couldn't pay, and I sent them one bill, and they couldn't pay, I realized I couldn't pay. That's okay. I stopped billing them. So he says they would do, the doctors used to take patients who couldn't afford it. And understanding, that's part of, you know, that's part of the deal, being a doctor, being well compensated and well respected, is you do take people who cannot afford to pay. You do also work on them. Of course, I don't know if dentists have ever done that. But I think the doctors, they're very good doctors. Doctors used to be, a lot of them, very, very good people, very dedicated. Now he says, I cannot do that. The way the system is structured, it's impossible to do that. And he says, it's just such a horrible system we have. I don't know any doctors that say is wonderful. They say, this is just terrible. It's terrible for the patients. You know, it's terrible for the doctors, terrible for the patients. I mean, but it's all being structured now in this super complex, sophisticated, high technology way, where when the crisis really gets going, technology people will be totally in charge of our healthcare, of our food system, of our educational system, of our banking system, over all the strings that enable us to function. They will be in charge of it, totally in charge of it. And then they will say to the government, hey, these religious kooks, you know, we find it so distasteful that we really cannot continue helping you out, you know. Uh-oh. You see what their MO, and their MO has been obvious all along. And there have been quite a few people in this world who have been very suspicious of it, actually. And I'm one of them. I said, there's something very, very bad about what's going on. It's a trap. We're being led into a trap. I knew it from the very beginning, and I told people, we're going to be led into a trap, and you better prepare for the time when the trap is sprung upon us. And Jesus knows for sure that we're being led into a trap. That's why 2,000 years ago, he warned us about this, and said that he's, at that time of the trap, he's going to come back, and he's prepared a place for us where we can dwell with him now. So it seems to be following along in that direction. But I'm not going to get ahead of myself. I'm just having these experiences where I was aware, like, hey, we may not have to worry about time and space in order to enter into this realm. We can enter into this directly. We've only put up this fence. It's like your neighbor's fence. You have a fence there, and you think, okay, well, they're over there. We're here. No, actually, if you remove the fence, it's seamless. The land is seamless, actually, isn't it? We've just put a fence there, and we're thinking, well, what was that thing that Ramakrishna did? They say that the mule, the donkey washerman, has this donkey, and every night they would slip this rope around the donkey's legs, and then they'd untie it, and the donkey would think that the rope's there, and so the donkey wouldn't move all night because thinking that the rope is there. We're so used to seeing these fences and thinking that divides us. Whereas the land is actually seamless, isn't it? The land, the earth, it is seamless. And time, space is like a fence, I think, that we think is there. But actually, isness, being, is absolutely seamless. And it's just accepting the seamlessness of it will enable us to simply go into another realm, so to speak. It is going along in that direction, actually. But we'll see how it develops. What's important is the MO of the New World Order, the MO of the Luciferians, the interpretarians thinking that what is being interpreted is dependent on the interpretation. Okay, hear that again. The interpretarians believe that what they're interpreting is dependent on their interpretation, which is why Jesus says, drop your interpreting, drop your thinking. Drop your thoughts and thinking that's interpretation. What is, isness is not dependent on interpretation. This is the whole teaching. Isness is not dependent upon interpretation. We think it is. So we think, and the interpretarians believe, that if they drop their interpreting, there won't be anything. There'll be only an abyss. You see the problem? If you go down the road of believing that everything that you interpret, and you're interpreting everything, it's dependent upon interpretation. If you believe that interpretation is primary and everything else is dependent upon it, it takes its meaning from it. In other words, definition. Everything takes its being from definition. If you drop the defining, the interpreting, the valuing of interpretation and definition, you drop that. You, of course you're going to believe that there's going to be a complete abyss there. What else could you believe? So, this is why the Luciferians are so terrified of truth, of spiritual teaching. They think that they're being pushed into an abyss. Now, of course that's the conclusion you're going to draw from a false premise. If your premise is that being, isness, is dependent upon your definition and interpretation of it, which is a false premise, then of course you're going to draw the wrong conclusion that if you drop it, there's going to be an abyss, obviously. But the fact is, the interpretation, the premise is wrong. So the conclusions are also mistaken. All conclusions coming from a false premise are also going to be false, obviously. Somehow this has escaped their attention, but once you get that, and recognize, hey, reason, you have reason within you. Reason is simply recognizing that a false premise as false, and that everything, conclusions derived from a false premise will also be false. That's what reason is. Processing and interpretation is not reason. Luciferians think it is. It's not. That's intellectual. The activity of defining and interpreting and thinking and thoughts like that, that is not reason. Reason seems similar, so there's a familiarity component. But reason tells us, hey, there's a false premise that isness is not dependent on interpreting and defining isness. God is not dependent on a definition of God. God is all. All is all. It's not dependent on any definition or interpretation. In fact, that has no effect on it whatsoever. Reason will tell you that. Therefore, that's a correct premise. So from that correct premise, reason will show you what the conclusion is. Oh, when you drop interpreting, drop defining, you will not be subject to an abyss. In fact, you will be subject to absolute stability and a fullness. Isness everywhere. Oh my God, isness everywhere. You'll be drunk on isness, as it were. Our love, as the poets like Rumi, various the various poets that, you know, have been very poetic about the experience is just drunk on the divine. The divine is everywhere. So the Luciferians are, you know, defending against an abyss is what they're defending. So don't underestimate them. You know, just because they're completely mistaken doesn't mean that they're not convinced of their position. They're just not recognizing the false premise, because that's the desire to be greater than God. You see? So they overlook that it's not possible, right? They overlook that. And when you overlook that it's not possible to be greater than everything, it's just a whim. If you overlook that, then of course you're going to have this absolute dread of the abyss and feel you're totally justified in taking any and all actions to defend against this possibility, you see? Because obviously spiritual teaching is saying very clear and without any ambiguity, drop your defining, drop your interpretations and let them go. As Jesus said, relax your mind, release your thoughts and let them go. Relax your mind, release your thoughts and let them go. To the Luciferians, this is saying, jump into an abyss, into the abyss of complete annihilation. That's literally how they take it. So of course, they are absolutely, fanatically opposed to this. And we'll take any and all measures to wipe out any and all expressions of this, anything that even remotely, what they don't realize is the truth is within them. Truth is within them. And so that continually threatens their belief structure, that truth is dependent upon interpretation. And so they project this threat outwards, and they see everything, you know, as a threat to their stability, to, you know, and they feel they're on the edge of a cliff always. And so they feel something's trying to push them off the edge of this cliff into an abyss. And so they want to control everybody, you see. They project this fear out into to everywhere. And they feel, I gotta control everybody. I gotta control everyone's actions, what everyone's doing. I have to control. I have to wipe out this teaching. This teaching is really crazy. They're trying to push me into an abyss. This is the mindset of the interpretarians, the Luciferians. That they say, God is subject to my definition of what God is. Isness is subject to my definition of what isness is. That's what they believe. False premise. So unfortunately, these interpretarians are all over the cosmos, and they're always feeling that they're being pushed into an abyss, and sometimes they have to flee from this. They're fleeing from their own projections, and they're always searching for a safe haven. Always searching for a safe haven. Now, they have decided upon this planet Earth as a safe haven for them. Okay, they're very serious about this. They said, we believe that this can be a safe haven for us, or at least a very important part of our safety. Okay, they have a safety plan. They have this plan how to be safe. Safe from God. Safe from the abyss, actually. To them, God is the abyss. Because in order to realize God, you have to drop definitions of God, right? Of course. God is the indefinable, because it's the everywhere, zero dimensionality of pure spaciousness, where wherever you go, you're always exactly where you've always been. Therefore, there isn't any definition, is there? There is not. And how do you find zero? There's no definition. So they view it as an abyss, so they see this planet as their safe haven. So they have come here. They have come here. What do you mean by come here? Well, the mindset, and our mindset survived the death of the body. Okay. Our mental body, there are different subtler bodies. Those survive the death of the body. And this mindset, the interpretarian mindset, the very severe interpretarian mindset, we call them Luciferians, have decided to come to this planet. And so they took they take a birth. They identify with a newborn bodies here, born. And these are the younger generation, a lot of the younger generation are these interpretarians who came from other dwelling places in the cosmos, actually. Previously they dwelled there, which is why they're born with just this naturally understand programming, understand coding, understand gadgets, understand superheroes, their whole culture that they bring, you know, that's their tendencies they brought with them in their subtle bodies when they came here. Subtle bodies, they can travel here easily, and they take a birth, so to speak, in this world, and now they've got a body, they're moving a body around here. But their tendencies, their culture, all this stuff, they already have with them. That's why these people say, you know, where'd you get all this stuff? They bring it with them, of course. Previous experience. They also bring with them a great dread, a great fear, false premise projections of spirituality, of religion. They have a phobia. They're religiophobic. Extremely religiophobic, Christophobic. You know, the real problem on this planet is Christophobia. Religiophobia. And they're just relentlessly propagandizing the planet, of saying that religions are the cause of all evil. You know, that's just a projection of their fear of the abyss. Okay, they're the ones who have the problem, actually. Now, the wisdom of religion understands that in order to, they talk about the problems that religion bring on planet. Yes, there have been problems, but keep in mind that the people that are bringing about these problems are the luciferians who are trying to repent and struggling with it. So of course there's an unsteadiness when you've been absolutely terrified of this belief in the abyss, that God is an abyss. When you drop your definitions, you'll fall into total abyss. You're not going to just drop those definitions directly. You're going to struggle with it. So religion is a struggle, actually, but it's a necessary struggle. It's an unavoidable struggle. So either you repent here in this world, or you're going to repent in some other world or some other place. There's no two ways about it. You're going to have to go through the struggle. And you're going to need help. So you're going to be very happy at some point that not everybody believed in your nonsense. That religion was terrible, that was wrong, it was evil, it was crazy, it was mythical, sign of mental illness, etc. Not everyone fell for that nonsense, okay? You'll be very happy to find that out at some point, because, you know, it's a religion, the path, the spiritual path is a struggle, it's an ordeal. You're going from believing that if you drop your definitions and interpretations, you're going to go into this total abyss of total annihilation. That's your belief. You're absolutely certain of it. You're so certain of it. You're going from that to recognizing that when you drop your definitions and interpretations, you're going to find yourself in absolute bliss of complete stability and fullness without any possibility you could ever lose it. So you cannot get a greater difference or contrast between those two, right? So the path is bit by bit by bit by bit by bit by bit, gradualism, which is why these religious institutions of discipline, morality, and ethics are so important. They are the support system for gradualism, which is absolutely essential. If you remove all the support system for gradualism, and you will rightly conclude that you can't do it. And then if you say, well, then you wrongly conclude, well, if I can't do it, it must not be doable. That's wrong. You just, you know, iconoclastically destroy the support system to do it. And then falsely claim that, well, it's too difficult, therefore I can't do it. Therefore, if I can't do it, it can't be done. Therefore, I don't have to do it. There is no such goal. And all this false belief system, denial, all that denial, snowballs. And then you think, hey, you know, then you think, hey, all I have to do is define what reality is, and that's what it is. No problem. No problem. And then you're stuck in defining and valuing and interpreting. And you're stuck with this dread of the abyss. It's still there. still there. And then you continually feel you need to go somewhere else. Well, I don't feel comfortable where I am. I got to go somewhere else, you know. So it is an incredibly bad thing to try and wipe out institutions that are designed to support the spiritual path. And yet that's what's happening on this planet, because of this great concerted effort for the interpretarians to make this planet their refuge from the abyss. What they feel is pursuing them, the abyss of insanity. They think that religion is insanity. Of course you would think that if you believe that what religion is teaching is that you're supposed to jump into this abyss of annihilation. Of course you're going to think it's insanity. What other conclusion could you draw? So don't underestimate the fact they believe it is insanity, for sure. And yet they're the ones who are suffering from insanity, thinking that if you give up interpretations and definitions, that means you'll be jumping into an abyss. Just the opposite. You realize that there's absolutely nowhere you can go where you haven't always already been. There's nowhere you can go where you're not exactly where you've always been. In other words, there is no abyss. It's completely impossible that there be any abyss whatsoever. That's the truth. That's what religion is actually teaching. But, of course, in a slow, bit-by-bit ordeal, struggling way, because it can be a long road to turn it around because of the fear, the dread. Absolutely. We have a tremendous continuity problem. What I teach is that there's only one problem, and that's the continuity problem. And this is true. Is how do you go from believing that you're surrounded by an abyss and only your definitions and interpretations prevent you from falling into it, to realizing you don't need any definitions or interpretations whatsoever. You are in total fullness of non-abyss. There's complete non-abyss everywhere. And no matter where you ever go, you will never find the slightest abyss anywhere, ever. There's a continuity gap, right, between the two polar opposites like that. And so realization, it seems to be, even though it's so wonderful, it seems so different that we're terrified of that. Even though we know this is true, we're saying, yeah, but it's such an abrupt change of total change, such an abrupt total change of experiencing, thinking that I'm defending from falling into an abyss and then realizing there's no abyss whatsoever to fall into, none whatsoever, you know. That's such a shock. So that's our real problem. That's our real problem. That's the cat just went up the tree. And the only problem a cat has when it goes up a tree is getting down from the tree. Okay? That's the continuity problem. We've gone way up, climbed way up this tree, now we're up on the top of the tree. The cat climbs this tree, goes up the top, and looks around and says, huh, okay, nothing here, not much here, I think I want to go back down. Uh-oh, how do I go back down? My claws don't work in reverse that way, you know? And so the cat is like, you hear cats getting treed, right? They can't get down. So we're like treed in this belief of that reality is dependent upon our definitions and valuing and interpretations. How do we get back down? Bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. Now this cat has figured out a way how to get down. I watched it. And it kind of twists its body so its hind legs are actually in reverse of going down. And it's able to get its claws like a brake. It's able to get its claws, normally the claws like this, it twists it around like this, and it breaks itself as it goes down that way. It's very, very clever, very clever. Now a big fat cat can't do that. You see, this cat is very slender and lithe and can twist its body around like that, and it just breaks itself, breaks itself going down. Very, very, very smart cat. So you have to break yourself on the spiritual path gradually, bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. You go away from this false premise and false conclusion of the abyss. like the great guru long jumper, everywhere. It's all the same. It's all the same problem. Fear of the abyss. It's fear of the abyss. Fear of the abyss. I think if they let go, there'll be an abyss. Of course, that is true for all everyone, all of us. I'm no different than that, than anyone. And what I'm saying is the real fear, because there is no abyss, therefore the real fear is the continuity problem. That's the actual problem. Continuity fear is the real problem we have. There is no abyss. And even if we realize there is no abyss, we still say, oh my God, the contrast between our total set of expectations and what we've been experiencing, think we've been experiencing, and the actual experience of no abyss is like night and day. It's like being in a dark cave, walking out in the sunlight, you know, thinking there's no sunlight. Oh, we see all this everywhere. Sunlight's everywhere. But it's too shocking for us. You know, we're used to the dark. So so we have to work bit by bit by bit, gradual. Nothing succeeds like familiarity. There's no other option for us, which means we need time to do it, which means we need to spend our lives doing this, which means we need a simple world structure which enables this. Now, there used to be way more people realizing truth, realizing the oneness in the past. Why? They had time to do it. They had time to do it. They lived simple lives. They planted the crops, you know. And the work might have just been menial hand work. You know, a lot of times they could just sit, you know, or they're a shepherd or something. They're a shepherd. They take the sheep out to the, and they sit there all day. I think St. Patrick, one of the great saints in Christianity, who realized oneness, was a shepherd. Sitting out there all day, practicing, spiritual practicing, bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. A simple world, a simple situation, enables us to use our time appropriately. Whereas the super complexity, super rat race, and super propagandized nature of the world right now, whereas all free time is supposed to be used indulging yourself sensually, okay? The fanatic about how you use your time here, the Luciferians. They insist that using your time with spiritual practice is a waste of time. They insist upon that. You're supposed to be going somewhere. You're supposed to be doing somewhere. You're supposed to be recreating. You're supposed to be doing stuff that's really physical, you know, intense physicality. You know, go out there and ride your mountain bike. You know, go out there and kayak. Go out. You gotta be, you know, instead of quiet contemplation, you never, ever, ever see Luciferians promoting quiet contemplation. They're terrified of it. They think they might fall into the abyss, which doesn't exist. So, you might say they're hallucinating an abyss. It's not there. So, Jesus tells us this is all hallucination, actually. It's a hallucination, and we need to stop hallucinating, but that's not an easy thing to do. If it was easy, we would have all done it long ago. It requires time. For me, it's been 36 years. It's 36 years going on 37 of gradualism. Absolutely, gradualism. Now, some do it quicker than that. For sure they do. Some, you know, take longer. For me, it's been a very slow, long path. But I would say that's very normal. And we tend to be so frightened of the abyss, we think we need talents and skills to define the abyss. So we spend our time working on these talents, like creative talents. Like for me, it was like music. That was a protection against the abyss. Thinking, if I can just generate songs and in my mind and everything, then at least I'll have that, even though I'm in some abyss, you know, thinking like this protects me from falling into abyss. But gradually I realized none of that's necessary. That's why very few people actually practice or contemplate at all. They actually spend their time thinking, you know, creatively, what can I do that will distract me from the abyss? You know, how can I define it? How can I define it in a beautiful way? Okay, the cat is now coming down. See, this cat is very good at it. There you go. Successful. That's like contemplation. You become very, very skilled at it. But very few actually do any of the practices. They're too frightened to. Too frightened to. They don't do any of the exercises, any of the practices, continuity practice. Don't actually do it because they feel it might be successful. And wait a minute, you mean I got to drop all my definitions of my problems except for one? Exactly, yes. That is the great, actually, shortcut that I've discovered. Not I discovered, it was the Holy Spirit that gave it to me. And says, look, I've been looking for a shortcut my whole life. I said, Holy Spirit, how can people be helped really? Are there any shortcuts so we can really shorten the path? Of course, everyone's been looking for shortcuts throughout history. And there's all sorts of different shortcuts that can be used if you actually use them. But this continuity problem approach is a tremendous, miraculous shortcut. And what it does is says that I don't have all these different problems, infinite problems. I only have one problem, but I do have that problem. So in other words, all the efforts we're using to, see, we want to generate endless problems that we're working on, that we think that protects us from the abyss. We got to define problems. I got to define this, interpret and define. Those are all our problems. And so what we say is wrap all those problems up into just one problem. Just wrap them all up into one problem. And that's the continuity problem, which is true. It's actually the only problem we have. But it's a very severe problem. Okay. So we feel secure. We have this huge problem. It's just one problem, but it's huge. And it's also very severe. And so we feel protected from the abyss in that way. However, it simplifies our approach to tremendous extent. And then we can just work directly on that one problem. We don't have to work on millions of problems. Just this one problem. And then what I found is we can actually start practicing on resolving this problem. And then that brings actual success. Actually brought the vision of oneness to me in intensely practicing the continuity problem. And I said, there's no abyss. Oh my gosh. Imagine the relief of someone who's believed for eons that if you drop thinking, defining thinking, interpreting, that you'll fall into a complete abyss of total chaos and annihilation. Imagine if you see there is no abyss. How much relief that is. How much relief that is. Well, I can tell you, it was this sense of vast relief. Vast relief. Just from practicing the continuity problem. Very smoothly brought this experiencing to my attention. But then I thought, wow, people think I'm crazy if I have this vast sense of relief, you know. So it's like, wow, I gotta get my structure expectations on this, that this is what I'm going to be experiencing. Wow, that's like the ultimate wow. It's really the ultimate wow. When you see that there is no abyss, that's the ultimate wow. And I've experienced that several times, consciously. You know, in dreams I've experienced it. But this was driving, you know, driving on a street. I consciously was experiencing it as I was driving. I just said, this is really great. Wow. This is what I really want. It is what, there's only one experiencing we really want, and that is the experiencing of there's no abyss. That's what we really want. The other stuff, we don't really want it at all. Because all these problems of how do I defend against the abyss, what we say is, I don't have those problems. Because there is no abyss. So those can't possibly be problems. How do I defend against the abyss cannot possibly be my problem, because there is no abyss. But my problem really is that there is no abyss. That's a fact. Because I'm not ready, I'm not ready for it. It'll be too much relief. Too much good, too much awesome. Right? It's too much awesome. So we have to practice rehearsing, getting ready for that awesomeness, that awesome relief. There's no abyss anywhere. I saw it. There's no abyss anywhere for anyone. For anyone. Now, even your worst enemy, there's no abyss for them either. Now, your worst enemy is just somebody who's projected onto you that you're trying to push them into the abyss. So they're trying to push you into the abyss first, you see. There's not even an abyss for them, for no one, for anyone. That's what you, there is no pit, there is no hole, there is no abyss for anyone. This is the vision of oneness. This is what you see. This is what you know. You say, wow, how great is that? If there's no abyss that you can be pushed into, who's your enemy? Who is your enemy? And where is the guilt? Where is the guilt? You're perfectly free. You're perfectly safe. There's no abyss at all. So how can there be any guilt? How can there be any enemy? How can there be anger? How can there be fear? There isn't any. There isn't any of that. There's only love. Happiness, pure happiness. That's what the vision of oneness, you're experiencing that. Wow, just love, pure happiness, pure safety. Everything's perfect. Wow, there's no abyss at all. Never has been. Never has been. Now the ego will say to you, wow, that's really cool. How did you fix the abyss? How did you get out of it? How did you escape from it? That's the trick question. It was never there. It was never there. So when we're nervous about this, hearing this, speak of the continuity fear. So the continuity fear, the continuity problem is the only problem I have, is the only problem that is, there is no other problem, right? So all this people thinking about this abyss, and they seem to have infinite problems. Wow, how do I avoid it here? And how do I avoid it over there? And they think there's all separate problems. I've got to work on this. This is a problem. This is a problem. This is a problem. There is no abyss. So none of those problems are problems at all, actually. How do I escape the abyss is not a problem. It is not a problem. So you have to insist you do not have that problem. That problem does not exist. Has no value for you. In other words, you refuse to entertain any thoughts or interpretations or valuing of that problem. It doesn't exist for you. Be very adamant. This problem does not exist for me. Only the continuity problem exists for me. It's the only problem that there is. It's the only problem that exists, which is true. This is not a trick. This is literally true. The continuity problem is the only problem I have. It's the only problem anyone will ever have. This is a fact. And then you say, the vision of oneness resolves the continuity problem for me because I'm seeing. Okay, I see you. Oh, no abyss for you. I see you. No abyss for you. I see all equally. I see them all equally in the same light. Oh, no abyss for anyone. No abyss anywhere. No abyss anywhere ever. Wow. Let me just abide in this. Relief. I love this relief. I love this relief. Now, Luciferians, the interpretarians, are constantly trying to get relief through sex, through drugs, through music, through, you know, all sorts of whatever ways they can find relief. Because the terror of the abyss constantly hounds them, and they just want some relief from it. But they refuse to repent, which means to accept there is no abyss, and to accept they actually have only one problem, which is the continuity problem. Repentance is very simple. It is to say, there is no abyss, but I do have a severe continuity problem, and I'm going to hold on to that, and I'm going to gradually work on it. Yes, that's what God wants for us, to accept we have a continuity problem. Repent, 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 for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. But you don't throw away all problems. You do have one problem left. You do have one problem left. You are not immersed in the ocean of being. No. Okay. Not directly. You have a continuity problem. So you work on it, and gradually, you evaporate the fear. You evaporate the fear. Gradually you evaporate the fear. And so the vision of oneness can dawn, and the relief can dawn upon you. But even that is still subjective, object-subject, so to speak, that you're experiencing this relief. Ultimately, you go beyond even the experiencing of relief, of course. But we're not worried about that. That's the final result of this. But that's down the road. And that's Jesus says God takes that step for us, so to speak. We're not even worried about that or even thinking about it. We're just focusing on abiding in the relief, abiding in the true relief. And the Luciferians, interpretarians, you know, they don't get it. You talk to them about this total relief, and they say, wow, I guess we'll have to have like constant sex for you know, every moment of the day forever. And so, well, that's, I need all these drugs to be able to do that, you know. They think of relief in terms of physical relief. You know, they don't see it as spiritual relief. Okay, spiritual relief. That's why on the path, it's very, very much advocated that people refrain from all of these physical forms of relief, okay? Because that gives a false picture of what's going on, very false picture. Spiritual relief of a vision of oneness, of a recognition there is no abyss, that is the relief. You realize you don't need all these thoughts, interpretations. You don't need all these other problems that you've been working on. You don't need to do anything. You're safe, you're free. You're safe, you're free. You've always been, everyone's always been. So the behavioral recommendations on the spiritual path that form these religious practices and disciplines, which they're very wise, they're very helpful, and almost necessary, you would say. Very pragmatic. See, religion is actually based on pragmatism. The disciplines, religious disciplines, it's based on pragmatism. Absolutely, what works, what works, what works. And so what Luciferians are doing on this planet is trying to destroy all pragmatism on the planet and take this insanely idealistic notion, that somehow they don't need any pragmatism. Well, of course they're insisting they don't need any spiritual path, because God's at the mercy of their definition. Reality is whatever they define it to be, and they just need to have more and more happiness will come from more and more power of definition. So we ask, hey, say, got happiness yet? And they'll say, no, we don't have it yet. That's only because the religious kooks are making us feel uncomfortable, is what they say. Get rid of those and we'll have happiness. No, we don't have the computers, we don't have the computational power yet to be happy, but we're almost there. We're working on it. They're always working on it. But they don't ever have happiness yet. And they constantly need relief from, you know, sex, drugs, rock and roll, relief from the, you know, strain, terrible, you know, suffering they're having. They haven't quite finished yet. Meanwhile, the truth is within them is constantly giving rise to this dread of the abyss. Because it's formless, it's definite, can't define it, definition-free formlessness that is all is. They feel persecuted by it, can't get the happiness. They want everyone to be slaves, to work on more computational power, more processing power, more interpretive power. They want everyone to be their slave on this. They want a whole world, everybody, slaving on it, and then this, you know, cheap, oh yeah, go to Vegas, you know, whore it up, gamble it up, drug it up, you know, just be decadent and get your relief then get back to slaving on it. More drugs, more stimulants, work harder at it. We need more computational power, you know, we've almost got it. And of course, the reason why we're not happy is always those religious kooks who refuse to accept our definition of them as reality, their reality. This is where we're at in the world, right? We're right smack dab in the middle of it. Raging forest fire. The whole world is on fire, actually. The whole world is on fire. The world will be destroyed by fire. Well, it's on fire right now. This computational activity is fire. It's on fire. iconoclastic fire. It's ideological fire. The world's on ideological fire. The fire of spiritual iconoclasm. Burning down the house of pragmatism, of what actually works to resolve your continuity problem. There's only one problem anyone has, and that will always be true. No matter where you go in this universe, there's only one problem you'll ever encounter, and that's the continuity problem. There'll never be any other problem you encounter. It's very reassuring to know this, right? It simplifies, greatly simplifies your perspective. You don't have to deal with all these other problems. There aren't any of these other problems. Don't exist. Because all these other problems is, how do I keep from falling into the abyss? Well, there is no abyss, so it's not a problem. How do I keep from falling into it is not a problem. Everyone's problem is, how do I accept that there is no abyss? That's the problem, and that's a continuity issue. And so you can help them with the continuity issue, and you say, well, there are these practices, and there's these ways of structuring your life that are pragmatically effective, and so that's what you need to do. And you need gradualism, bit by bit. Therefore, you need to have a lifestyle that works for, right? Lifestyle. Since it's bit by bit by bit, you're going to need a lifestyle, which means discipline. Means discipline, your time, how you, right use of time, right use of mind, right use of time. Simplicity, simplicity, simplicity. So you have the time. You know, meditation, contemplation, prayer, quiet time, sitting quietly, sitting still, sitting quietly, commitment to that. All of that is pure pragmatism that works and is absolutely necessary. So wherever the Luciferians go, they can never escape the truth that there is no abyss. They can never escape that truth. No matter how many supercomputers they build, they can never escape the truth that there is no abyss. Okay? And so they can never escape the spiritual path. Nobody can. Which is the gradualism of evaporating the continuity fear. That's all it is. The gradualism of evaporating the continuity fear. There is no other path. There's one problem, one path, one solution, actually. The one problem is the continuity problem. The one path is the gradualism of evaporating the continuity fear. And the one solution to the continuity fear is the vision of oneness. That's it. This is universally true. Universally true. Now, as Jesus said, there's not a universal curriculum because the uniqueness of everyone, meaning the actual structuring of everyone's life, will always have a unique flavor to it, of course. But there are universal facts, and you know, truth is true. That's a universal fact. There is no abyss. That's a universal fact. And there's only one problem, there's only one path, and there's only one remedy. That is universally true. The one problem is the continuity problem. The one path is gradually evaporating this fear, continuity fear, and the one resolution of the continuity fear is the vision of oneness. That's it. That's it. That's universally true. That is the trinity of universal truth. There's the trinity right there, actually. So from a pragmatic standpoint, there is a trinity. Now, I know Islam is saying there's no trinity. There's only monotheistic, only God. That's true. There's only the oneness. Only the isness, that's it. Without any second or anything else. That's true. But from a pragmatic standpoint, also, there's the pragmatic standpoint of those who have this continuity problem, believing in the abyss. The Luciferians need to be saved, the interpretarians, which is us. Religion is for the purpose of saving those. So there's also a pragmatic side to the coin where there is this trinity of continuity problem, gradualism on the spiritual path, vision of oneness. So we say the Holy Spirit represents pragmatism, okay? And the Son of God represents the vision of oneness, also pragmatism. So how you structure pragmatism, how you look at it, there's a place for that too. There's a place for that too.
There's really
not a conflict at all. But because of the continuity fear and the fear of the abyss, people project upon other religions. Religions project upon other religions their own continuity fear, thinking that's a magical solution. It's not. It's not. We're supposed to be, you know, beyond that now, recognizing the true ecumenical fact of all religions. Okay? The true ecumenical fact of all religions. The necessity of discipline, right? The necessity of gradualism. They have that all in common, is the necessity of gradualism, the necessity of pragmatism. See, the commonality factors between all religions are greater than the differences, way greater. The necessity for salvation, separation, the necessity of liberation from this inner dread, dropping our definitions and seeing, we need to see it all as one. They all have that in common. The necessity of gradualism on the path, they all have that in common. See? The necessity of repentance, they all have that in common. It's the acceptance that there's only one problem, it's the continuity problem. That's repentance, saying, hey, there's one way, gradualism, and then the vision of oneness, all is one. So they all have that in common. The trouble is, the struggle of the continuity fear, the tendency is to project. That's what they've always been doing, project. And they say, well, I can just get rid of this dread, inner dread, struggle, by projecting the cause out there. And it's that other religion is causing me to feel this dread and difficulty. So if I just attack them, that'll get rid of it. And it seems a lot easier to attack someone else than to deal with this inner dread. Because this inner dread seems intractable. You know, it seems overwhelming. So it seems so much easier to attack and kill someone else, get rid of them. That's why the admonitions, thou shalt not kill, is so important. The Ten Commandments are very important, actually. There has to be, you know, there has to be this commitment that the only problem I really have is the continuity problem. And gradualism is the only way. And a commitment, thou shalt not kill. Jesus says forgiveness is the heart of pragmatism, which is true. So Jesus is super pragmatic. Forgiveness is the heart of pragmatism. Without forgiveness, the path is going to fall apart into projection and attack and guilt. Projection, guilt, attack. You're going to fall back into that. So you've got to always forgive, and say, look, whatever I'm trouble, it's a projection of my own fear of the abyss, and I've got to work more on my path and be more patient. Forgiveness and patience, I would say, are the keys. We do not live in a patient world at this point, which is, you know, we do not live in a forgiving world. The popular media and culture, entertainment, news, they're rapidly unforgiving. Now, I was looking at this website talking about the Ebola situation. Here's an example. And it was talking about this guy, was it Patrick Sawyer or something, who brought from, was it Liberia, something like that, to Nigeria, the Ebola, knowing that he was infected. And there was all these comments by Nigerians about this. And it was very interesting. Most of the people there are religious. And a lot of them were cursing him and saying he's going to burn in hell forever. Okay, a lot of them were that way. But there were a few, there were some comments sprinkled in there throughout of, I forgive this man in Christ's name. I forgive him. God forgives him. There's only love. There's only God, Christ, the Holy Spirit, and love and forgiveness. And I forgive this man. I was amazed. I said, wow. You know, they're see, so there is that difference within religions of those who get forgiveness as the way and those who are still struggling with it and saying, well, I can forgive the good people, but the bad ones, no, you know, they're going to burn in hell forever. Because they think they're being pushed into the abyss. This person is pushing down the abyss. Remember, there is no abyss. So the message of Christ gets through as well as the message of other messengers, okay? Absolutely. gets through. And forgiveness, may God have mercy on their soul. May God forgive them, because I forgive them, certainly. I know God forgives them. I too can forgive them. My problem is not this person. It's my continuity fear is my problem. I only have one problem. I don't have a Patrick Sawyer problem. I don't have an Ebola problem. I don't have any of those problems. I have a continuity problem. And if I put my effort and intention and work on that continuity problem, I know for sure there's only one remedy for it, and I'm going to find that remedy, which is the vision of oneness. And when I see the vision of oneness and I'm experiencing it, I know I'm going to experience this total relief that there's no abyss whatsoever. Total peace, bliss, relief. My God, love for everyone. There is no abyss at all. There's never been any abyss. So there's no question of how do I escape it at all. There's no need for defining or interpreting whatsoever. All I need to do is just experiencing of this. There are no answers. There's no questions to answer. It's never been there. That's the answer. So there's no question, how do I escape it? No. I realize it's never been there. It's not an escape, it's a realization. So obviously there's some Christians and Muslims in Nigeria, they're both, that they're forgiving, and there's some who are not forgiving, right? That's the struggle on the spiritual path. That's the struggle with the fear of the abyss. The fear of the abyss is so extreme. We've been so deluded for so long that forgiveness is a struggle. It's a struggle. And you have to undergo that struggle. You think somebody did something terrible to you, if I just attack them, I'll get rid of this fear, this feeling of uneasiness, instability I have. No. The only problem I have is the continuity problem. There is no abyss. There is no abyss. So my fear is really the fear of relief, total relief. Endless relief. Unending relief. Unending relief is my real fear. And so let me work on that as a positive. See, the spiritual path should be positive, a very positive path, like wow. And we should be practicing in a positive way, like holy cow, getting used to, I'm going to be experiencing this unending, pure relief. And that's what I'm afraid of. That's all that I'm afraid of, actually. So in the past I have done these very positive exercises, but it there's no response, almost none. And so then I kind of feel like, what's the use? Because people are still struggling with lack of forgiveness. And lack of forgiveness means basically they're saying, who do I attack? So I forgive almost everybody, but I know if I just find the one person I'm supposed to attack and I get rid of them, then I'll experience the full relief. No. There's only full relief right now, always and always. It has nothing to do with anyone else. There's no abyss for anyone. So you can't have an enemy. You literally cannot have anyone opposing you, anyone pushing you, any enemy whatsoever in truth. So your problem is always the continuity problem. It's never somebody else. Okay, my problem is always the continuity problem. It's never someone else. Never. And that will always be true. And what a relief that is, because then it's entirely in your control, right? You can evaporate the continuity fear, and then you realize you don't have any problem. No one has any problem at all. Unending problem freeness is what the vision of oneness shows you. Unending problem freeness for everyone. There's nothing to forgive. See? So, but you must constantly guard against getting angry at people. And this is what the spiritual path tells you. You cannot get angry at people. They are not the cause of your problem. You only have one problem, and that's the continuity problem. Everything else you think is your projections of the continuity fear, projecting it as if it meant it was an abyss problem, and then other people feel, then you feel automatically they're trying to push you into the abyss. Automatically you'll feel that way. But when you say, no, there is no abyss, the only problem I have is a continuity problem. The abyss has problem has absolutely no value for me. It doesn't exist. It doesn't exist, therefore has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. The vision of oneness does exist. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. It's the only value that exists. There is no other value. Then you realize, oh, I can practice and get ready for the vision of oneness. And then you feel positive, you see? Puts you in a state of grace. Puts you in a state of grace. This is true. This is pragmatism. This is the pragmatism of the Holy Spirit that's trained me, has shown me. This is pragmatism. It works. Thanks be to Jesus. Thanks be to the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to all spiritual teachers, messengers, etc., who've ever come here to help us out. Forgive, 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 forgiveness. Always forgiveness. Thou shalt not kill. Jesus says attack is never justified, okay? This is a very central part of his teaching. Attack is never justified. Attack is never justified. Right, because there is no abyss. Nobody's pushing you into any abyss whatsoever. If there's no abyss, how can anybody be pushing you into any abyss? And how can you be pushing anyone else into any abyss too? You're innocent too. As I said, one of the great declarations is, I am innocent. All are innocent. All are innocent. See, this is how we prepare for the vision of oneness, is positive declarations. All are innocent. All are innocent. I am innocent. You are innocent. We are all innocent. Okay? This is it. I am innocent. If you want to know, if you want to do declarations, powerful. This is one right here. Powerful. I am innocent. You are innocent. You are innocent. All is innocent. All is innocent. All are innocent. Yeah, you can say all are. All are innocent. All are innocent. Is innocent. Is innocent. Is innocent. Is innocent. I am innocent. You are innocent. All are innocent. I am innocent. You are innocent. All are innocent. I am innocent. You are innocent. All are innocent. There is no abyss. The abyss problem. I don't have an abyss problem. The abyss problem doesn't exist. Only the vision. My only problem is the continuity problem. The abyss problem is not a problem. It doesn't exist. Has absolutely no value for me. Okay, so we can say, I have one problem, I confess I have one problem, a very severe problem is the continuity problem. There are no other problems. The abyss problem is not a problem. The exist problem is not a problem for me. It is not a problem. It does not exist. Only continuity problem is a problem for me. See, keep saying that. So, I don't have I do not have an abyss problem, I have a continuity problem. I do not have an abyss problem, I have a continuity problem. The abyss problem does not exist and has absolutely no value for me. The abyss problem does not exist, therefore it has absolutely no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. I am innocent, you are innocent, all are innocent. And no matter where anyone ever may go, they are always exactly where they've always been. They are always exactly where they've always been. I do not have an abyss problem. I have a continuity problem. The abyss problem does not exist, therefore it has absolutely no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. I am innocent. You are innocent. All is innocent. No matter where I may ever go, I will always be exactly where I've always been. No matter where you go, you will always be exactly where you've always been. No matter where all goes, anyone ever goes, they will always be exactly where they've always been. All is exactly where it's always been, always and forever. All is always and forever exactly where it's always been. All right? These declarations prepare us for the vision of oneness, and this is the only preparation anyone needs to make is preparation for the vision wedge. That's it. That's it. So I can say for a fact that any of you who are actually practicing these affirmations and experiencing the temporary consternation, like wow, the wow of it, long actually, if you're actually practicing it, for sure, because it's effective. Now, I spent a long, long time processing spiritual and not practicing. I wanted to see, will that work? It didn't work. Jesus was right, it didn't work. But along with that, everything was seeping into me, seeping in. So eventually I could start practicing. When I started practicing, boom, it worked. So I know, I wanted to evaluate. And so I know what works and what doesn't work. There's no doubt about it. You can spend a lifetime thinking, processing, interpreting, evaluating, defining all highest spiritual teaching possible, and you will not wake up. You will not have the vision of oneness. You will not realize your true nature. You will not. And I've seen many, many people do this their entire lives, and they will not recognize the truth. But when you actually start practicing, very much more quickly than you realize, you actually will. It will dawn upon you. The vision of oneness will dawn upon you. Now you will jump back and say, wow, I didn't expect to be that effective. You know, of course. And so there'll be a delay, time of delay, where you basically realize, why was this so effective and the other wasn't? Go through that process, go through that of recognizing, say, hey, wow, this works, that didn't work. This works, that didn't work. Why? And so there's this further sort of evaluation, and you move your comfort zone. But you go more and more towards these declarations. I am innocent. You are innocent. All is innocent. I do not have an abyss problem. I have a continuity problem. The abyss problem doesn't exist. Therefore, it has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. I do not have I do not have a forgiveness problem. I have a continuity problem. The forgiveness problem does not exist. Only the vision of oneness exists. Only the vision of oneness has value. The forgiveness problem has no value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. See, there's nothing to forgive. There's no abyss. So we need to keep reminding ourselves of that self. The forgiveness isn't a problem. It's automatic. You know, we have to keep reminding ourselves. There's nothing to forgive. There isn't any abyss. We're presuming that it's possible to be pushed into an abyss. So we're prejudging everyone as to, you know, well, this could cause this. This will cause this. So I can blame you for that, even though it hasn't actually happened. It's kind of like everybody's rehearsing blame, you know, like, who are we going to blame? We're going to protect ourselves in the abyss by finding someone to blame, and then they're the ones who are trying to throw me into the abyss, therefore they're going to be thrown into the abyss and not me, and that by seeing them thrown into the abyss, I feel safe somehow. But how safe can you really feel if you really still believe there's an abyss? So this is the problem about those who are struggling with religion, for instance Christianity, thinking that all the evil ones are going to be thrown into the eternal abyss. And by seeing them, somehow I'm going to get the satisfaction like, ah, I'm safe because I didn't get thrown into the abyss. But you're still going to feel the abyss is there. And if you, you know, somehow go wrong, you could be thrown in the abyss too, you see. So that's not really the solution at all. The solution is to see there is no abyss. Never has been, never, can't possibly be. And if you believe that there's an abyss, there's no way you can experience the relief of no abyss. That is God, actually. You can't experience God as God. you will experience them as an interpretation, and God as an interpretation and a definition. And you'll still project the fear of the abyss and still see others as evil and wicked and needing to be cast into the abyss so that you can experience the relief that they can't be pushing you into it. Okay. So this is a struggle that Christianity has gone through. It's not Christianity has gone through, it's those who need the discipline, okay? They're struggling, the struggle. It's a struggle that has been gone through, and some are emerging out of this struggle, okay? And seeing, okay, this is what it was all about. Now I see, in hindsight I see it. But you don't see it as you're struggling through it, you don't really see it in hindsight very well. However, it's super helpful to have those who've gone through it giving you the hindsight. Even though you think, I don't know, maybe they're nuts, I don't know, I don't get it. It does seep through a little bit, and you say, maybe there is no abyss. Maybe there isn't, you know. Maybe this whole idea of the sinners being cast into the eternal lake of fire and being annihilated and burned forever, and maybe that's not true. Yeah, maybe. So it is helpful to have those who have gone through this struggle and have hindsight. And so that's the whole point of this whole structure we have here is benefit of hindsight for those who are still struggling. It's very important. And the right for those who are struggling to have the benefit of those who've gone through it in hindsight, have access to the saints, the sages, the saviors, the avatars, the wise, the holy, the sacred, the blessed. Have access to the realized ones, the saved ones, the liberated ones. Okay, to have it, literally have access to their hindsight, and I have had access to it because I insisted upon it, because I was definitely committed to the path. I was willing to benefit from the hindsight of these great teachers telling me, you know, this is what you should expect, this is what you're going through, this is actually the remedy. And then you get access to their books, but not only that, you get access to them, literally. Because there is no abyss, so there's only eternal life. There is no death. There's no abyss to fall into at all. So they are eternally present for us to help us out with their hindsight, which is why I have had access to, for instance, Jesus Christ, Ananda Mahima, Longchenpa, Krishnamurti, Ramana Maharshi, St. Francis now. I've had literally access to be in their presence talking with them and getting their advice. And everyone on the path should realize that they have that same access. This is why it's so dangerous as far as delaying what these Luciferians are attempting on this planet and doing. Is they're trying to convince you that once a body dies, that's it, the spirit's gone forever. What they're trying to do is create a wedge between the body of spiritual practitioners and being able to consult with those who have already gone before them to get the hindsight, the benefit of hindsight, which is super helpful and important. Without that, you know, like in India, the guru lineage, you know, the lineage of the gurus, you have access to all the gurus in your lineage, like Sikhism, Hinduism, Tibetan Buddhism, Buddhism. You have access to the Buddhas, okay? For us, we have access, Christians, we have access to Jesus Christ, literal access to Jesus Christ, as well as all the saints, like St. Francis. I wasn't seeking access, but St. Francis said, hey, I'm here for you. Brother, I'm here for you. And I'm super happy to be able to greet you like this, you know. I said, wow, that's great. You get hindsight from, so Luciferians are trying to drive a wedge into that and say it's all mythology, it's all insanity. Once anyone dies, that's it, they're annihilated forever. Therefore, anyone talking about access to those who have gone before us on the path, those who have the perfect hindsight, they can give us this hindsight and say, this is what to expect, this is how you can keep going. They say, you should not have any access to that whatsoever. It's a sign of mental illness. You need to be treated for that. You need to feel as though that trying to access that is extremely guilty, extremely wicked, extremely bad, extremely stupid. You're uneducated. Anyone who tries to access that belongs on the lowest levels of society. That you should be pushed down into the most degrading levels and ultimately no job at all, no means of support, no way to survive. That's their goal. That's their goal. Because they know if we break that string of access, we break that stream of access, turn away, turn our back on that. The spiritual path gets too difficult. It gets too difficult. I could not have succeeded to the extent I have without the help of my teachers, for sure. No way, no way, no way, no way. I would have given up long ago. Maybe committed suicide long ago. You know, I said, I can't do it. I know I have to do it, but I can't. Bring suicidal impulses. If you know you have to do something to be happy, and then you think it's impossible, you can't do it. You feel suicidal. And so the Luciferians are really have a suicidal agenda for the world. And it's very true, because I know that the ego always counsels me. If I ever get down and turn the ego, what do you advise? Always the ego says suicide. It says, hey, yeah, you got to get there, but you can't do it. Therefore, suicide's the only way. That's what the ego counsels us. The Luciferians are bringing a suicidal agenda to the world for religious people, saying, again, driving that wedge, saying, no, there's never been anyone go before you. You have no access to those who have. You don't have no help in any way. You got all this pressure to drop it. And you'll just feel like, wow, I know I need to do this, but I can't do it. So it's hopeless for me. It's hopeless. So Luciferians bring about this sense of hopelessness. That's their goal, you know, to dispirit the world. To dispirit the world. That's their goal. And then, of course, they then can conveniently project onto you and blame you and say, you're the wicked ones, need to be cast into the pit. Because, you know, you're trying to tell us to jump into the pit, right? Yeah. So by all means, it is supremely helpful and important to have contact with those who have gone before us, to hear their words, hear their teachings, and to actually meet with them, It is super, super helpful and important. For me, I've always believed this with all my heart, saying this is absolutely crucial. And, you know, so far, the meetings have been on the inner spiritual meetings, not physical meetings, you know, but in spirit. I meet them in spirit, which is what they really are, which is what we all really are, is just spirit. For me, this is super important. And I know it's very important for everybody. That's why the guru system is so important for many, is you have a teacher, and they have a teacher, and their teacher had a teacher. And you have this lineage. You have access to this lineage. You have access to the full hindsight of this lineage. You have access to the full hindsight of this lineage. Luciferians are trying to break up all those lineages, break it all up. Go watch the movie or television or something. Right, and you have, they say, hey, you got access to 1,000 channels on this television. This was a UHD, curved UHD now, Samsung, curved UHD. You've got access to curved UHD, 1,000 channels on curved UHD. That is your lineage. Hollywood is your lineage, is what the Luciferians are telling us, is Hollywood is your lineage. That's the only lineage you have. Is that what you want? That's what they're going to insist for you. Now, what I've done here is produce, you know, a tremendous number of videos. So if you really feel like watching a movie, here you go. This movie, I'm sure, for those of you who have ears and eyes to hear, you know, ears to hear it, eyes to watch it, is way more compelling than any movie Hollywood has ever made. Way more compelling. This information here is intense, is wow, is really a gigantic wow. You have access to all the teachers there's ever been. Not only in your lineage, in all lineages, actually. Now, you made me feel more comfortable with your lineage, okay? And everyone understands that. You know, and you may feel it's an abyss to go into another lineage, you know? I mean, I didn't feel it was an abyss when Longchenpa introduced himself to me. I didn't know who he was, or what his lineage was, or anything. But I said, wow, I really like you. I can see you have a great hindsight. I recognize it. Wow, here's someone with tremendous hindsight. I love this. Please help. Absolutely, please help. I accept your hindsight. Please, let's meet again. Let's meet again. Please, I want to meet again for sure. Same thing with Sri Ananda Mahima. I said, wow, she's not part of my Christian lineage, you know. But I said, holy cow, I can see you got like perfect hindsight, perfect perspective. Thank you, thank you. I want to benefit from this. Please, please, yes, let me benefit from this too. The more support, the better. The more support, the better. Same with Ramana Maharshi. I recognize he had perfect hindsight. He knew exactly what my situation was and how it resolved, and he insisted it was going to resolve very favorably. He said, it's going to be tremendous. You're going to be tremendously helpful what you're doing. And he was viewing this from hindsight. So I trusted his hindsight. I said, wow, I believe what you're telling me. Save my life. Save me from suicide, really. Ramana Maharshi saved me from suicide. Because he conveyed to me his certainty of his hindsight. You know, just stay with it, he says. It's going to be very helpful. And I knew he was telling me the truth. So I trusted in that. I said, wow, hindsight, you see. Now, you say, well, why can't, you know, why couldn't Jesus save me from that? Why? Because the Luciferians are working so intensely and have been for so long here in the world, is they're able to disrupt to some extent our faith and our trust. And sometimes it's helpful for an outsider, some other lineage to come in and say, hey, no, what Jesus is telling you is absolutely true. You know, yes, 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 keep, stick with what you're doing. Ramana Maharshi says, stick with what you're doing, which is the path that Jesus has, and the Holy Spirit has laid out for me. He didn't say, switch over to who am I, you know, his way. He said, no, stick with what you're doing. This is very important. I told him, I said, hey, look, I see what the way you did it. Okay, the way I'm doing this is a little different, right? And he said, yeah, I see exactly what you're doing. And it is different, it's a slightly different style, emphasis. He said, but it's just as good as who am I, just as good as the way I advocated, which is who am I. What I'm advocating is the continuity practice. He said, it's just as good. Just as good. Don't worry. Okay. Stick with what you're doing. He didn't say, switch over to the way I did it. He said, stick with the way you're doing it, which is, stick with your, you know, the advice the Holy Spirit and Jesus are giving you. You see? So they know. They know. Hindsight knows that there can be different ways of emphasis, and the way I'm emphasizing the continuity practice is extremely effective, as is, of course, the way Ramana, who am I, follow the root of who am I, that can also be extremely effective for those who feel, you know, feel that this is the way. Now, I would only say, as far as like Ramakrishna is concerned, where he tried all different ways and said, yeah, they all work. That's great. But I do not advocate you to be some person who tries all different ways. That was very unique. What he did was very unique. What he was doing was trying to bring about an ecumenical forgiveness around the world. Was saying, look, all these paths work. So just stick with the path that works best for you. Don't try to be this grasshopper hopping around and saying, well, yeah, I'm going to do this path. And abandon the path you're on. I'm going to do this one, abandon that one, trying to be some super spiritual superstar. Like, hey, look, I took all paths and they all work. That's folly. Unless that your particular mission that's already been done, Ramakrishna did that. But the teachers will advise you, hey, you stick, like a Sri Ananda Mahima advise you, everyone came to her, she said, look, stick with the path that you're on, that your lineage, it works with you. She told Buddhists, stay a Buddhist. And realize through the Buddhist path. If you're Christians, he said, stay with Christ and realize the vision of oneness through Christ. If you're Hindu, stay as a Hindu, she said. He said, but of course, respect the other paths, that they too work. They all work. Okay, this slightly different emphasis, different labels, you know, whatever. They all work. Gradualism works. Vision of oneness works. We are all one, remember, we are all one. As I said, I met with Jesus last night in spirit, and you can't find a more humble, unassuming being ever. I said, Jesus, you're the king, you know. You're the king of leading salvation, you know. And yet, you're like completely unassuming. But that can only come from oneness, you know. Oneness. Experiencing oneness. Not having an experience, but experiencing it continuously. It can only come from that and nowhere else. So I know he's experiencing the vision of oneness continuously and even beyond that, with where there doesn't even need to be any. So it's not an effort to be humble. It's automatic that way, automatically that way. Okay, very great. So what's your lineage going to be? Is it going to be Hollywood or the Vision-Of-Oneness lineage? Okay, that's it.